Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 5th July, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 11. We look at them in detail. The first one, LG bound by ANED advice of Delhi government, says Constitution Bench. So this is the very important ruling of the Supreme Court, which has come forth now. This was in news yesterday too, regarding Delhi. So Delhi is a union territory, but with a special status too. Out of the 7 union territories, actually there are 2 union territories which have elected government. That is the chief minister. So here, Delhi chief minister or his Aam Aadmi Party government, which got a huge majority in Delhi assembly elections and had formed the government, was seeing that its work has been obstructed by the lieutenant governor. So lieutenant governor, governors in union territories have more powers and they can refer matters to the president, to the center. So on every issue, it was seen that the matter was being stalled. So here, the Delhi High Court as such gave its order 2 years ago in August 2016, you can see. So this order in August 2016 of the Delhi High Court gave the Lieutenant Governor complete control on all matters regarding the National Capital Territory of Delhi. So its ruling meant that there is a need for concurrence of the Lieutenant Governor on every matter. But now the Supreme Court, where the Delhi government went in appeal, the Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal. So on this judgment in appeal, now the Supreme Court has ruled that the Lieutenant Governor is bound by the aid and advice of the Arvind Kejriwal government. So that is a democratically elected government. So if there is difference of opinion, yes, Lieutenant Governor can refer the matter to the President, but he should straight away refer the dispute to the President for a final decision. He cannot sit over it. He cannot stall governance in the state or union territory. So that is the ruling. So he says, the ruling says that Lieutenant Governor has not been entrusted with any independent decision making power. He either acts on the aid and advice of Council of Ministers or he sends the decision further to the President and accordingly implement it. So this is the ruling. Also, the Supreme Court has at the same time warned the Lieutenant Governor against sending every trivial dispute with the government to the President. That should not be the case too. So this has been clearly stated. So here you can see the details are provided. Since Delhi is a union territory, a national capital territory, it has powers on all subjects in the state list and concurrent list, the democratically elected government in Delhi, but except on land, police and law and order. So these still remain in the hands of the central government. So that is there. It does not have any full statehood. So though that is the demand, as such of AAP to Aam Aadmi Party, but presently it has no full statehood status. So this is there. So here you can see the details which we discussed are mentioned here. The next is, this is regarding the statements given by the judges on the constitutional bench. And this is Supreme Court ruling applies to Puducherry to CM. So Puducherry Chief Minister says that the ruling of the Supreme Court applies to his union territory too. The Congress-led government is in power in Puducherry, and here the Lieutenant Governor is Kiran Bedi, former IPS officer, the first woman IPS officer of the country. So here also it has been seen that in Puducherry, on several issues, there are conflicts and the governance is affected here. So the same ruling, the Chief Minister of Puducherry says that this applies to our state as well. So the Lieutenant Governor should not obstruct every matter of governance in the union territory. So these two are the only union territories with an elected government. Other union territories like the Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu, Andaman and Nicobar, Lakshadweep, Chandigarh, they are directly governed by the center. So here you should know Puducherry geographically too. Where does Puducherry lie? So this is Puducherry, surrounded by Tamil Nadu, Karaikal, another part of Puducherry. So there are 4 parts. Puducherry, Karaikal, Mahe, surrounded by Kerala, and Yanam here, surrounded by Andhra Pradesh. So these 4 parts together form the union territory of Puducherry. Now also a question arises that why are these parts separately kept? Why have they not been integrated into respective states? Why these small island regions are there? So this, the reason here is that these are the areas which were governed by French, not by the British. So these were under French rule. So even after India got independence in 1947, French still remained here and they left later. So this regions here, they have a separate culture, separate historical administrative system. So that is why they have been kept separate as a union territory called Puducherry. Similarly, also you should know Goa, Daman and Diu, Dadra and Nagar Haveli were not under British rule. These were under the rule of Portuguese. So Portuguese ruled here. And they were the ones who left after police action as such, after 1947, in 1960s. Then next is MSP for paddy hiked by rupees 200. So minimum support prices have for kharif crops have been announced, and the announcement for minimum support price for paddy, that is for rice, has been increased by rupees 200 per quintal. So this actually comes to a percentage of 12.9% increase. So earlier, last year it was 1550 per quintal, and now it is 1750 per quintal. So this is also an election year. So it has been stated that this is no surprise announcement, because earlier also in election year, UPA government has announced even 20.8% hike in MSP. Even 60% hikes have been announced. So this is not a significant hike, has been stated too. Also, MSPs for 14 commodities have been announced, and major hikes have been seen in cereals like paddy, as well as bajra, jawar, ragi, and also for cotton. So this is it. Also, another thing which is said is that minimum support price is fine, but minimum support price is the price at which government procures. So if the paddy is one of the major kharif crops and it is directly procured from farmers by the Food Corporation of India, but there is no guaranteed mechanism for procurement as such for other crops too. And for paddy also, in states with strong procurement machinery, this MSP would be beneficial. For other states, it is said, like farmers in Bihar, Assam, UP, in the northeast as such, it will not help because procurement machinery is not strong enough. So even though the government is providing this MSP, the market may not necessarily buy the commodity at that price. So that is another drawback. Plus, also another important point is that this MSP once has been announced, and the government says that this is 50% higher than the cost of production, as has been promised, that MSP would be 50% higher than the cost of production. But this is without including land cost. So cost of production without including land cost. So actually it is said that if land cost would have been included, then instead of rupees 200 increase, there would be a 700 increase per quintal at least. So this is also another drawback. So that's what it is, that MSP for kharif crops have been announced based on A2 plus FL costs. Means family labor is included, but land cost is not included. So C2, which includes land cost, should have had been included. That has not been done. So here that detail is also given, you can see. So A2 means actual paid out of cost on seeds. That is like on seeds, irrigation, etc. And FL is unpaid family labor. So C2 is equals to A2 plus FL plus rentals or interest foregone on owned land and fixed capital. So all these together form C2. So it has been A2 plus FL which has been used, not C2. So here you can see MSP based on C2 costs will be far higher than the proposed figure has been shown. So 50% increase had to be done on C2 costs, it would have had been much higher. For paddy as well as for cotton, it has been shown. What the government has done presently is this. Then next is horrified by fake news, WhatsApp. So yesterday we saw in news that how the government is asking WhatsApp to act against the fake news which has been propagated through its medium. So now, responding to that government letter, WhatsApp says that it is going to take measures to prevent the misuse of its platform. So number of steps have been taken. Also, the company has announced unrestricted monetary award for research on spread of misinformation on its platform to address this problem. Also, changes are being made in the WhatsApp. They are making, you know, changes in group chats as such to spread unwanted information. Also, there's new setting that enables administrators to decide who gets to send messages within individual groups. So that is also there. And for the first time, even WhatsApp is working with a fact-checking organization to identify rumors and false news. Also, one change which they are making is that a setting which will make it sure that whether a message is being formed by the person who has sent it or whether it is a forward. So that can also be clearly known. And working with fact-checking organization, WhatsApp has already done in recent presidential elections in Mexico. So whenever there is any forward being sent, so such messages are sent to this consortium called Verificado. So this was done in Mexico. So this Verificado would provide regular updates on what was accurate. So similar steps can be taken in India also. Fact-checking organizations can be in place which verify whether the message is doing the rounds, are rumors or true. Also, it should be an independent, credible organization. Otherwise, it would have no standing. Then next is ISRO to test its astronaut escape feature today. So this is regarding ISRO's test, which is going to take place called pad abort test. So this is launch pad abort test, PAT. So this test involves aborting a space capsule at launch to save the inmates. So experimental space crew capsule would be sent as such. So in future also, when ISRO plans to send Indians to space, so this is an important testing which is may taking place presently. So again, once the test takes place, it will again be in use. The test is slated for to take place at ISRO's Sriharikota launch venue, the Satish Dhawan Space Center, which is located here in Sriharikota in coastal Andhra Pradesh. Even ISRO Space Application Center of Ahmedabad has provided devices that enable satellite communication and navigation for this flight too. So India is planning for a human space flight program. So many experiments would take place on those lines, and this is one of those tests. So here you can see the details are provided regarding this pad abort test to save the crew escape system. And this is the location of Sriharikota geographically too in Andhra Pradesh, coastal Andhra Pradesh, where satellite launches take place. Then next is special category status not feasible. Center tells Supreme Court. So central government has filed an affidavit in the Supreme Court. Actually, it's a counter affidavit file. So this, it says that it is unable to give special category status to Andhra Pradesh. It says that all commitments under AP Reorganization Act of 2014 have been addressed. So it has listed out in the next year to the counter affidavit all the financial and other forms of assistance which have been provided to AP and Telangana since bifurcation. So it says that 15,970 crore has been released to the successor states of AP for 3 years from 2015 to 18. So this is out of the post-devolution revenue deficit grant that was 22,113 crore for 2015 to 2020 based on the recommendation of 14th Finance Commission. So the state's revenue gap also, for that also money has been released, and the balance also has been stated by the central government. So this special category status demand had been in use quite often earlier too, so you should know complete detail about it. So here you can see the details are provided. The present special category states are also shown. The northeastern states, Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. So criteria is that they have hilly terrain, low density, location along the borders and are economically backed. So that is why they have this special category status, and they are provided 30% of the total central assistance. So this is the benefit which they get. They get special plan assistance for projects too. 90% of this also is grants. Even in this 30% assistance, 90% is grant. So even United Special Central Assistance is provided to them, which is 100% grant. Means you don't have to repay it. Grant means not to be repaid. It's not a loan. So here you can see for externally aided projects also, assistance is provided as 90% grant. For AIBP also assistance is provided. Even incentives for promotion of industry etc. is given. But this practice has been discontinued as such following budget 2015-16. So central assistance are discontinued now. Special central assistance and special class assistance are all discontinued. So very few externally aided projects remain. Also allocation under AIBP has been reduced as such. So that is why the benefits or the which the special category states got, that has been diluted now post the budget 2015-16. And here the criteria for special category status is shown, what Ministry of Commerce and Industry says, and even with respect to the Planning Commission. So that's what hilly and difficult terrain, low density, economic and infrastructure backwardness, strategic location. Even Ministry of Commerce says if it's geographically isolated, inaccessible terrain, poor resource base, remoteness to larger market, or if it has poor infrastructure, so it comes under special category status. So with respect to Andhra Pradesh too, actually then Prime Minister, former Prime Minister Narendra Modi had assured special category status would be accorded to the newly formed state for 5 years. But present government disapproves this. It has not gone ahead with it. Then here again, the details are provided, which we just discussed, the benefits and what AP wants, Andhra Pradesh wants, as such that it lost revenue after Hyderabad. Hyderabad was capital of Andhra Pradesh, but after bifurcation, Hyderabad is now the capital of Telangana. So Telangana's capital is Hyderabad. So it lost revenue after Hyderabad, which accounts for over 60% of the state revenue, became the capital of Telangana in 2014. So that's why AP demands assistance from the center. But the center has rejected special category status because it says it became irrelevant after the increased devolution of funds from the center. So from 30%, 42% allocation is going to states as such by the center post the recommendation of 14th Finance Commission. Also, it says that special status was not part of AP reorganization. So here you can see the 11 states with special category status, the northeastern states and Sikkim, seven sisters, and Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, and Uttarakhand are the present special category status states. Then next is Union Cabinet clears DNA profiling bill. So the Union Cabinet has cleared this bill that allows law enforcement agencies to collect DNA samples and create DNA profiles and special data banks for forensic criminal investigation. So this bill is called DNA Technology Use and Application Regulation Bill 2018. So this bill has been framed by Department of Biotechnology. So it's a DNA profiling bill as such, and activists argue that the manner in which DNA information will be collected and where it will be stored by forensic laboratories is a violation of right to privacy. So that is the claim being made. Also under the bill, a DNA profiling board would be established, which would be the final authority that would authorize creation of state level DNA banks and approve the method of collection and analysis of DNA technologies. So this is an important bill which would be initiated. The cabinet has cleared it. Now it would be introduced in the parliament. So here you can see the details of this too. Like it's used as an for evidence, and there is the concern of right to privacy too. So scientists vouched for DNA bill, but privacy activists fear it will lead to gross violation of human rights. In 1985, two Indian courts accepted DNA as evidence in criminal investigation. So the draft bill work had been initiated in 2003 itself. Then even CRPC has been amended to include use of DNA profiling of suspects. And DNA profiling, and then this, you can see the bill. Well, the government bill which has been proposed will be useful for crime scene investigation, maintaining database of convicts and suspects, even verification of missing persons, investigation of unidentified bodies, and even for research work. But activists claim that it can be used for racial and communal profiling. It is violation of privacy. Also, it will result in longer trial period, and even errant testings can take place and convictions can take place because of error in DNA profiling. So here details are given. So it's a technique in which sample of DNA is tested in a laboratory to generate information about it. So it can help police, federal agents, government officials, such, to locate, identify the origin of a person and where he belongs to, whom it belongs to, the print as such. So it's not, DNA profiling is not the fingerprint. From small sample of blood or any tissue, you can get the DNA, and from that profiling can be done and details of the individual can be brought forth. Then next is UPSCST panel sends quota notice to AMU. So Uttar Pradesh SCST, Scheduled Caste Scheduled Tribe Commission, has asked Aligarh Muslim University to explain why it is not following the quota system, though it is not having minority status. It says that Banaras Hindu University provides quota for OBCs, Dalits, and why Aligarh Muslim University is not providing quota. Now here we'll discuss this in detail too. So this letter has been sent to AMU. Earlier too, the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh had spoken, Yogi Adityanath had spoken on similar lines, and now the SCST Commission of the state has also sent the letter. So actually this issue is in conflict. The Supreme Court is looking into this matter, whether AMU has minority status or not. So still the matter is before the Supreme Court. A status quo has been ordered, means what is going on will continue. So AMU is governed by AMU Act of 1981. So which has granted minority status to it, and the minority institutions as such are exempted from providing reservation because 50% of the seats will go to minorities, so then they cannot provide further reservations now. So BJP has raised this issue of quota in AMU and Jamia Millia Islamia since the 2017 assembly elections. So now you should know that AMU has actually never followed the policy of reserving seats for Muslims. So seats are not reserved for Muslims. It reserves 50% seats for internal students, regardless of their religion or caste. So this is a statement given by the AMU spokesperson. And they say there's a stay order by the apex court on the 2005 decision of the Allahabad High Court. So till the Supreme Court finally determines whether AMU has minority status or not, the status quo will continue, is what the AMU spokesperson says. So you should know the background also. Aligarh Muslim University. It is a public university funded by central government. It was established by Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan as Madrasatul Ulum Musalmane in 1875-78. So here it became later as Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College, and the idea was to train Muslims for government services in India and prepare them for training even in British universities. So this Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College again later became Aligarh Muslim University in 1920. So this is the background. AMU has two off-campus centers too in Mamallapuram and Murshidabad. So this is AMU. Regarding Banaras Hindu University, with which AMU is compared, Aligarh Muslim University, and you should know about it, that it was founded by Madan Mohan Malviya. So Madan Mohan Malviya founded it at Varanasi in 1916. It was created under BHU Act of 1915. It is the largest residential university in Asia and one of the largest in the world too. So here, Madan Mohan Malviya was also the Vice Chancellor of Banaras Hindu University from 1919 to 1938. And about Madan Mohan Malviya, you should know that he is one of the founders of even scouting in the country. He was the chairman of Hindustan Times newspaper for over 22 years. He represented Indian National Congress at the Roundtable Conference in Britain. He was arrested twice for actively participating in civil disobedience movement too. He was given the title Mahamana by Mahatma Gandhi. So he's a renowned politician and educationist from India. He has also been awarded Bharat Ratna, which is the highest civilian award in the country. So this is there. So Banaras Hindu University was never founded as a university only for Hindus or only for some particular community. But yes, Aligarh Muslim University has its origin as founded for the minority community, though it says that it does not follow this policy of reserving seats for minorities. Then next is services PMI returns to growth in June. So this is regarding Purchasing Managers Index. So Nikki India Services Purchasing Managers Index has been released, and it shows that after a marginal contraction in May 2018, there has been growth in June 2018. So this data comes out monthly. So this is the fastest growth of expansion in a year, because in previous month it went down. So of course, then increase would also be significant in terms of percentage. So it is in May, it was 49.6. And now the reading in June is 52.6. So this is the fastest growing since June 2017. So if less than 50, this means there is contraction in the sector, and more than 50 means expansion. So you should know about this Purchasing Managers Index, which is a private sector survey. Monthly survey of private sector companies is conducted, and an advance indication is provided on what is happening in the private sector economy. So various variables such as output, new orders, employment, even prices are taken into consideration to come forth with this index. And as we discussed, the value and what it denotes is shown. Then next is copyright treaties get cabinet nod. So the Union Cabinet has approved accession to WIPO copyright treaty and WIPO performers and phonograms treaty. So these are the two treaties which have been provided to extend it to cover even copyright to the internet and digital environment. So Union Cabinet has acceded to these. So it says that this will enable creative right holders to enjoy the fruits of their labor, even through international copyright system. Which as such, they'll get return on investment made in producing and distributing creative work. So it will also help Indian right holders too on the same lines. So this is there. So you should know about WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization, which is a specialized agency of United Nations. It is dedicated to developing a balanced and accessible international intellectual property system. So this can reward creativity and stimulate innovation, which contributes to economic development and safeguards public interest. So this, you should know what is intellectual property too. Means it's a creation of the mind. It can be invention, literary or artistic work, symbols, songs, you know, music, names, images, designs, etc. Phonograms means related to sound vocals. So these are the treaties which presently India has also acceded to, that is accession. So that is WIPO Copyright Treaty and WIPO Performance and Phonograms Treaty, of which have been entered into force in 2002, and now in 2018 India has acceded to them. So the main objective is to adapt those rights of as such intellectual property rights to the digital online environment. Then the last news item is Google exports India public Wi-Fi model abroad. So here the export has taken place, means Google had actually collaborated with Railtel in 2015 to provide free public Wi-Fi at 400 railway stations in India. So now this Google is looking at it as a product, and it has been named Google Station. So it is going to provide, you know, initially 100 stations have been covered and this has been done. And now Google has taken this public Wi-Fi model further abroad too, in countries such as Indonesia and Mexico. So public Wi-Fi across the country can be provided. So even a study shows that if public Wi-Fi is provided, then 40 million new users get connected to the internet in 2019. So this will be the benefit. So this will give benefits in terms of increase in GDP too. There will be demand for smartphones as such too. So those benefits are also there. So India currently has around 36,000 commercial hotspots, which are quite few compared to those in China and Mexico. So such steps are being taken by various companies. You can see here Wi-Fi hotspots. Reliance Jio has plans to open 1.5 million public hotspots by the end of 2019-20. Even Facebook, in its express Wi-Fi project, Facebook has partnered with Airtel to open hotspots, and Google Station also provides this free Wi-Fi in collaboration with Railtel. So you should know about Railtel too, that is Railtel Corporation of India Limited. It's a telecommunication initiative by Ministry of Railways. It was established in 1990. You can see it's a mini Ratna as such, focusing on providing broadband and VPN services. So it's one of the largest neutral telecom infrastructure provider in the country, having a pan India optic fiber network. So it plans to make this infrastructure available for railways as well as for use for other nations. So in railways also it can be used for various purposes, for modernizing train control operation, safety system of the Indian railways. So this is it. So these are the news items. Thank you. Also, for daily coverage of current affairs on this line, you can enroll for our course, the online current affairs course. The details of which are provided here. Thank you.